Here we are once again at Grafted In. We're in the middle of a little series here talking about the momentous decision that is coming up in America over the coming election. I think the most crucial election in American history. America, as I indicated last week, has already started down a road in morality that where we are falling apart. We are losing our status in the world across everything. Educationally, we're no longer at the lead. Health-wise, we're no longer the healthiest nation. Wealth-wise, we still got a lot of resources, but we are a nation that probably in the next 4 years, if things don't change, will end up being $30 trillion in debt, and that's unsustainable. So, I mean, we're a nation headed toward total economic collapse. The Canadians, many of them, are absolutely concerned about this coming election because they fear that if we go the wrong way, America goes down, they're going to go down too, because the whole world would be pulled in that quagmire that goes down. And we talked about, at the end of the broadcast last week, about the most crucial decision that a nation can make. Let me remind you that Genesis chapter 12, Yahweh says, I will make Abraham, I will make you into a great nation, I will bless you, I will bless your name, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all people on earth will be blessed through you. And then we read in Joel where at the end of times, Yahweh the Creator says, I'm going to gather all the nations. All the nations of planet earth are going to be gathered through the representative armies in the time of the Battle of Armageddon in the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And God says, I'm going to enter in judgment with the nations. Last week, if you were with us, we shared that there are two judgments. There's the judgment that we face as individuals, whereby we are judged about our relationship with God's offer of salvation through His Son, Yeshua. That's the judgment you and I are going to stand accountable for. What is our relationship with Him? And Yeshua says He'll approach people, and for many, He said, many, not a few, but for many, even those who say, Lord, Lord, and they call Him Lord, He says, I never knew you. You weren't one of mine. You wouldn't follow me. And they're cast out, and others are invited into the kingdom that goes on forever and ever and ever. But separate from the judgment of individuals, there is a judgment of nations whereby all the nations of the world, Britain, France, Germany, Somalia, Canada, the United States, Mexico, South Africa, Australia, India, Pakistan, all the nations of the world are going to be represented in that battle. Very interesting, that says the whole world is going to be drawn into the Middle East. All the armies of the world are going to be there. Guess why they're there? They're all going to be upset over one tiny little nation. But they're all going to be there. And he says, I will enter into judgment against them concerning my inheritance, my people Israel, for they have scattered my people among the nations, and they divided up my land. NET says, they partitioned my land. So dividing Israel is going to be the one judgment of the nations. America may come to a point where Christians are persecuted. America will not be judged for persecuting Christians. America will not be judged at this judgment because they kicked God out of school. America will not be judged because, they supported gay marriage as a nation. America will be judged at the Valley of Jehoshaphat over one thing and one thing only. What did you do about my nation, Israel? And so in the upcoming election, there are two clear political platforms. I encourage you to get them. You can get them online and read them. The Democratic 2016 party platform, the Republican party platform. And as I indicated last week, we got to look at platforms. It's not fun looking at the candidates these days. I mean, craziness is going on. You know, who's telling the truth? Who's lying? Who has a foul mouth, who doesn't? I mean, there's just not a good choice in terms of candidates that would make you want to stand up and be proud. But we do have to look at the direction of the nation in terms of the platform of the party that's leading. And you and I are going to be held accountable for whether we voted what the platform stands for, because when you vote for that candidate, you're voting for their platform. Well, I didn't agree with that. Well, you did when you voted for them. When they stand up and say, I'm the Republican, then they are saying, I'm for the platform. When Hillary stands up and says, I'm the Democrat, she's standing up for the Democratic platform. That's what you are voting for. And while there are many things, many, many things in there that I believe a Christian, a biblical-based Christian, who's willing to open the Bible and lay the platform and say, what does my Bible say about this platform? You got to be blind in one eye and you can't see out of the other not to understand which party you have to go for. That's just very clear. But there's one little part of the platform, and it is, in the end, out of 55, 60 pages in each platform, you'll find it near the end of each of the party's platform when they start addressing foreign policy. And for the Democratic one, it's about that long in 14 size point. And if it's this one in the Republican, in actual regular type, it's about this size on a regular sheet of paper. They didn't spend a lot of time. Why? Because they don't think that's important. You see, they knew they had to put something in there, but they got paragraph after paragraph after paragraph about taking care of the economy, of how are we going to create jobs, of how are we going to do this, and what are we going to do this. And oh yes, at the end they got this little, we got to do something, we have to say something about the Middle East. In fact, the Democratic platform doesn't even call it Israel, they call it the Middle East. The Republican platform titles their section are unequivocal support for Israel. So the Republicans say it's about Israel, the Democrats say it's about the Middle East, and of course that's primarily Israel, because they think it's a small part. And my friend, it isn't a small part. America's going to be judged on this and this alone. And as I indicated at the end of last week's broadcast, the entire British Empire is no longer in existence because Britain broke the mandate and unilaterally divided the land that was given to them to protect for the Jews, and they gave 90% of it away to the Arabs, and Britain shortly thereafter began to fall apart and is no longer a world empire. Don't think that won't happen to America. Don't think you can sing God Bless America and that isn't going to happen. God will not be mocked about his promise that he's going to judge nations on what we do with Israel. So let me read simply these two platforms. I'm going to read them right out to you. The Democratic platform regarding the Middle East for 2016. In the Middle East, Democrats will push for more inclusive governance in Iraq and Syria that respects the equal rights of all citizens, provides support and security for Lebanon and Jordan, two countries that are hosting a disproportionate number of refugees, maintain our robust security cooperation with Gulf countries, and stand by the groups of the region as they seek greater economic opportunity and freedom. Glory to God. So that's the first part. It's about the Middle East. Now they got this little part here. They're going to talk about Israel. A strong and secure Israel is vital to the United States because we share overarching strategic interests and the common values of democracy, equality, tolerance, and pluralism. Well, yay for you Democrats. That's right. That is an excellent statement. I wish that you had presidents who supported it. But that is a good statement. A strong and secure Israel is vital to the United States. That is absolutely important. That is why we will always support Israel's right to defend itself, including retaining its qualitative military edge, and we will oppose any effort to delegitimize Israel, including at the United Nations or through the BDS sanctions movement. Good for you Democrats. You've got some right words there, because you better start doing that kind of thing. Next sentence. We will continue to work toward a two-state solution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, negotiated directly by the parties, that guarantees Israel's future as a secure and democratic Jewish state with recognized borders and provides the Palestinians with independence, sovereignty, and dignity. That is absolutely shortchanging what's going on. Number one, and I'm going to get to this after I read the Republic one. A two-state solution divides the land of Israel. No other way to put it. Simply put, a two-state solution, no matter what you call it, divides the land of Israel. Anybody supporting a two-state solution, you have put yourself into Joel chapter 3 as a nation to be judged by Almighty God for having divided his land. A two-state solution is directly against the Bible, against the Word of God. Glory to God. Number three, while Jerusalem is a matter of final status negotiations. Stop right there. Jerusalem to be divided is dividing the land of Israel. Come on, Jerusalem is in the heart of Israel. We'll talk more about that if we have time. So Jerusalem is not a matter for anybody to decide. God has called it in His book His city. And He's called a part of His people and His land. To divide Jerusalem is once again to put yourself into Joel chapter 3, verse 2, and to say you are in favor of dividing the land, therefore you as a nation will be judged. Glory to God. While Jerusalem is a matter of final negotiations, it should remain the capital of Israel, an undivided city accessible to all peoples of faith. By the way, any part of Jerusalem turned over to the Jordanians, the Palestinians, or anybody will not be accessible to all members of faith.
Right.
Back when the Palestinians and the Jordanians had control of half of Jerusalem, they had an opportunity to demonstrate to the world that we can respect everybody's religion. But what they did is destroyed every synagogue in their side of the city, made it difficult for Christians to get into that part of the city, and would not let Jews come to their holy places. Why would you think they would do any differently today? Glory to God. And then they end by saying, Israelis deserve security, recognition, and a normal life free from terror and incitement. Well, of course they do. Palestinians should be free to govern themselves in their own viable state in peace and dignity. Listen, Palestinians are free to govern themselves in the territory of Gaza right now. Nobody is controlling them in Gaza. The Palestinians, the Arabs in Gaza, Israel doesn't control them, Egypt doesn't control them. They have their own place, voted their own people in, they voted Hamas in, and they're using their free state to attack the free state of Israel.
That's right. Yes, they are.
They should be free to govern themselves. We know what they will do when they govern themselves. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now, let's listen. I know we're a little more stirred up for Grafted In, but you got to understand, America has a future or no future, and it will be decided in November. I'm absolutely convinced of that. And it will be decided based on what party platform gets the seat vis-a-vis Israel. Glory to God. Here's the Republican platform, which, by the way, upset all the liberals. The newspapers have been filled with Republican platform takes a decided turn to the right. Well, the Democratic one took a decided turn further to the left. We have a more polarized nation in America now ever than in the recent centuries. More polarized. We had a president who came in to say, I'm going to bring America back together. We're more polarized than we have ever been now. And here's what the Republicans said. They titled their part of the platform, Our Unequivocal Support for Israel. Like the United States of America, the modern state of Israel is a country born from the aspiration for freedom and stands out among the nations as a beacon of democracy and humanity beyond our mutual strategic interest. Now remember what the Democratic platform said. We have a mutual strategic interest. Beyond our mutual strategic interest, Israel is likewise an exceptional country that shares our most essential values. It is the only country in the Middle East where freedom of speech and freedom of religion are found. What a profound statement. See, they're coming right out and saying, let's put it right in our platform. We acknowledge that Israel's the only nation in the Middle East with freedom of speech and freedom of religion. Glory to God. Number one, therefore, support for Israel is an expression of Americanism. And it is the responsibility of our government to advance policies that reflect Americans' strong desire for a relationship with no daylight between America and Israel. Come on, we're coming out of a president who at one point made the Prime Minister of Israel go in the back door of the White House, who snubbed him. And this platform says, we want to make sure there's no daylight, that the world and the terrorists and the enemies of democracy say there is not even a sliver of daylight between Israel and America. Number two, we recognize Jerusalem as the eternal and indivisible capital of the Jewish state and call for the American embassy to be moved there in fulfillment of U.S. law.
Yes. Amen.
The law of the United States passed by Congress decades ago was that our embassy should be moved from Tel Aviv into Jerusalem because Israel says that's our capital.
Yes.
We have no right to tell a nation you can't have that as your capital. It has been passed by Congress and it's been reaffirmed by Congress, and every president to date, be it Republican or Democrat, has given a waiver of extension. Now, when you hear that a waiver of a law of Congress has been given by the president in an area of foreign policy, and it's not just Democrats, it's been Republicans, Bush did the same thing, then you have to ask logically one question. What is the common force undergirding or influencing the presidents of the United States, be that Republican or Democrat? What force can influence them to go against Congress for over 20 years now, and a simple fact of moving the embassy? And there's only one force, and it's called the United States State Department. The Department of State in America is controlling this aspect. So for America to get back in line of supporting Israel, we need a president who can rearrange and turn upside down the State Department, not one who speaks for the State Department.
Right, right.
Does this make sense to you?
Right.
Glory to God. We reaffirm America's commitment to Israel's security and will ensure that Israel maintains a qualitative military edge over any and all adversaries. We support Israel's right and obligation to defend itself against terror attacks upon its people and against alternative forms of warfare being waged upon it legally, economically, culturally, and otherwise. Number four, we reject the false notion that Israel is an occupier. Glory to God. Come on. We have a party. This is where they really went more right. They say Israel is not occupying the West Bank. Glory to God. The West Bank is the heart of the biblical homeland. When God said to return to his people, he said, return to the mountains of Israel. Glory to God. I have that somewhere. It's in Ezekiel 36. But you, O mountains of Israel, will produce branches and fruit for my people Israel, for they will soon come home. I'm concerned for you, and will look on you with favor. You will be plowed and sown, and I will multiply the number of people upon you, even the whole house of Israel. Where on the mountains? The towns will be inhabited, the ruins rebuilt. I will increase the number of men and women. I will settle people on you, as in the past. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. God said to his people, I'm going to bring you back from all around the world, and I'm going to bring you to the mountains of Israel. That is not Tel Aviv.
Right.
That is not Haifa. The mountains are Hebron and Shiloh.
Yes.
The mountains are Shechem. The mountains are in Bethel. The mountains are Bethany and Bethlehem and Jerusalem. The mountains are smack dab in what the world keeps calling the West Bank is the very land that God said, that's where I'm going to bring my people.
Amen.
And over 100,000 Israelis now live in the mountains of Israel. And any compromise to divide the land says, we're going to force them out. Just like we did in Gaza. Under the pressure of the United States, the Israeli government agreed to take all Israelis out of Gaza, even though they had a right to be there. And they evicted their own people. Can you imagine if the President of the United States said, we've discovered the Indians own Fitchburg, and so in 1 month we're going to take everybody out of Fitchburg, and you all are going to have to be relocated, and trust us, we'll find you housing somewhere, and we're going to give the land to the Indians. Well, that just couldn't happen. But the Israeli government evicted all their people as a token for peace. Maybe if we give you land, you'll say, okay, the Israelis want peace. Israel gave them land and got more war. Every time Israel's given land, they get more war. Anytime you give radicals more, they want more. It's a simple lesson. Glory to God. So the mountains of Israel are key. And the Republican platform, get back to that, it says, we reject the false notion that Israel is an occupier. That has never been in this platform ever before. Which means there's hope for America.
Amen.
There's hope that people in America will wake up to the idiotic liberalism that doesn't understand history, that wants to rewrite it, and where the radicals with the loudest voices are allowed to intimidate the public from having access to what the truth is. We reject the false notion that Israel is an occupier, and specifically recognize that the boycott, divest, and sanctions movement is an anti-Semitic in nature and seeks to destroy Israel. Therefore, we call for effective legislation. Now, Democratic platform said, you know, we're against the BDS movement. That's not right. The Republican platform says, we call for effective legislation to thwart actions that are intended to limit commercial relationships with Israel or persons or entities doing business in Israel or in Israel-controlled territories in a discriminatory manner. In other words, we want national legislation that says if you form an organization to pressure businesses to boycott Israel, then the government will no longer do business with you. Period. End of story. The next one, the United States seeks to assist in the establishment of comprehensive and lasting peace in the Middle East. Notice the phrasing. The U.S. seeks to assist in the establishment of peace to be negotiated among those living in the region. In other words, Secretary of State, keep your nose out of the discussion.
That's right.
President of France, keep your nose out of the discussion. We will do whatever we can do to provide a place, provide money, provide transportation for you guys to sit down and talk it out. But we will not behind the scenes be trying to influence your decision. We oppose any measure intended to impose an agreement on or dictate borders or other terms. And we call for the immediate termination of all U.S. funding of any entity that attempts to do so. Listen, what they've said. President Barack Obama said, Israel needs to return to the 1967 borders. Number one, those 1967 so-called borders, Green Line, they weren't borders, it was a truce line. Number two, was there peace when those lines were there? No. If we get back to there, then everything will be okay. It wasn't okay when they were there. That's when the war to destroy Israel began, when they were at those borders. And so we've had a president who has stood up and demanded that Israel return to those borders. What do you think that does to their power to negotiate with the Palestinians? We as a nation in the last 8 years have gone down a trail that one more venue the same, we will have succeeded in throwing Israel to the wolves and America is finished. That's Bible. That's not Don Long. That's not my political rhetoric. That is simply what's going on in the scriptures. Glory to God. And then their last statement, our party is proud to stand with Israel now and always. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So let's get back to that blessing and cursing. So Yahweh says, I, Yahweh, will make you, Abraham, into a great nation, and I will bless you. Has he done it? You better believe it. Israel exceeds every nation in the world except ours, simply by the sheer volume of numbers we have. But if you do it on per capita, in other words, how many patents do they have in Israel for every 10,000 citizens compared to how many patents do we generate in the United States per 10,000 citizens? If you do it on per capita basis, Israel exceeds America in just about every standard and the rest of the world in all of them. They have more academic achievement. They read more books. They build more trees. Talk about a nation that's green. Israel builds more trees per capita than any nation in the entire world. They have more venture capital. More new technology comes out of Israel than even anywhere per capita. Absolutely amazing. American technology is heavily invested in Israel because they have a creative genius. Why is it that Jewish people with less than 1% of the world's population have, like, I forgot the number, I think it's somewhere around 17-18% of the Nobel Prizes? Why are they so smart that they're acknowledged in medicine, physics, and all that? By the way, how much Nobel Prizes are awarded in the Muslim world? You can count them on one hand. There is a creative genius in the Jewish people that has no rational explanation. There's no genetic explanation. There's no way you can look at it and say, how can any one race exceed so exceedingly beyond any other ethnic identity in the world? It's because God said to Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to make you a blessing to the world. And what is the one nation most of the world and most of the United Nations wants to see destroyed? It is the nation God is blessing humanity through. Destroy that nation, and you've destroyed the world. Divide that nation, and your nation will be judged. This is Pastor Don Long, and I sure hope this has gotten you to think about some things. I urge you to do your research online, and tune in next week as we continue to look at the most crucial election in American history that's coming up in November.